confident people is.
But this place. Okay, good. And we are 25% to the top.
No, we have our 15.
So, Poya.
Poya, oh, sorry.
Well, okay, well, we were supposed to start at 9, we actually started at 9:30 and just had a break, so. Anyway. Okay, good. So, what we just did was install a working copy, right? It seems to be working. Cover the initial installation of the sources, the indexes, stuff like that. Create a sample configuration file that works against the production Maya, works against a semi-production instance of Mendes, searches the box, does it break, and does it break pretty quickly, with in 30 milliseconds or something like that. So far so good. The other thing that I wanted to show at this part, by the way, is the string scale. Well, just so you know, basically, it's as simple as this. So you configure instead of a single listener on the native API port 9312, which is, by the way, an official port with IANA, something like this. There we go. We also add an employee. We also declare an additional listener that runs MySQL protocol. We start the daemon. Okay, it says it's all the one. We stop it, we bring it down, we launch it again. Okay, the listener is here, and now we can possibly connect to SearchD using the MySQL client. Okay, so this is the Linux thing. We have to do this to connect to using the TCP port instead of the Unix socket. Okay, good. We're just connected to SearchD. So let's start from, non-local Linux, search for best. Obviously not a message you expect from SQL. So let's start from test one. Full scan requires the same data for one of the groups. In this particular case, we can't iterate over all the rows and regions because we do not have any attributes configured. In that case, we optimize and we do not store a redundant list of all the IDs. If we had any attributes, select graph from test one would work by default. At this point, we need to provide a keyboard. And you it like this. Where match IP? Okay, so no IPAs have been mentioned in the bug reports. Where match test? Okay, there we have it, the results. The IDs, the weights, so on and so forth. We do not have any attributes in the index that we've just built. So there's nothing in the results set except for the document ID, the row ID, and the attached full text weight. If we have any attributes, we would have something else. Well, let's do that, by the way. I mean, it's a question of 10 second hack session, right? So let's start from this bug table where ID equals 1. Let's, for instance, index the handler ID field. I believe the handler ID is the ID of the user that the bug is assigned to. How do we do that? So, we need to pull the column from the database, and we need to declare it as an attribute, handler ID. And by the way, even though we still have the search team running, sort of confused. Anyway, let's start up the demo. Give me a sec, putting up all the redundant sessions. Okay, there we have it. We do have a search demo running. It's still running off the old releases. And so let's start from test 1, it's still not going to work. Full scan requires 600 Dragonfly and we can't really see the handler ID just yet. Okay, no handler, no handler ID. For an obvious reason, we've just added it to the configuration file. We did not rebuild the index, it's running off the old index data. So for these changes, for these handler ID changes to take effect, we need to rebuild the index. We can do it on a fly, actually. Should be able to, unless it crashes. The index, if the indexer says it will not just go and override the index because something is already using it, and you need to use so called rotate. Goddamn. Okay, rotate again. The rotate option. And 10 seconds later. Or maybe 20 seconds later, okay, it's 9.5 now. And there we have it. The handler ID just appeared, so what just happened? We've modified the configuration file to include some new color, basically changed the index definition. We rebuilt the index on the fly. SearchD was, well, running all the time and was working all the time. I don't, from this beginning, I don't quite understand why it did took 2 seconds to handle this query. Perhaps that was some hiccup with the slow AGD on this machine. The subsequent queries are going to be instant. And there we have it. The handler ID is just started appearing in search results. Plus, by the way, select star just started to work as well. Because we've just added some equities to the index. And yeah, you can use, you see, you can use a regular MySQL client to talk to a search daemon. Do stuff like query by keyword, query without keywords. You can do this, for instance, where handler ID equals 42. Where, no, you can use it when you don't doing table like myself. There are certain, well, syntax quirks at this point. So, for instance, order by ID in scanline order is not going to work. This is a stupid quirk which will be fixed in the future. This is going to work because, well, you know, Russian magic. The internal column, the internal virtual column name starts with an at sign. Well, you know, it's just a syntax quirk. At some point in the future, just ID is going to work.
I have a question. When you do the search, you do the, when you search for the keyword test or something, you use the full text search of Sphinx. But when you add additional additional limit, like where user ID is 42, what algorithm do you use? Do you first do the full text search and then do sequential thing? Or,
let's look at this query, for instance, where handler ID equals 42. What happens internally is this. We store the attributes in a separate file, actually, which gets cached into memory. This is the file, test1.spa, it looks like this internally. So, yeah, gibberish. Well, except with hexadecimal form, it isn't gibberish. It's the ID, it's the attribute value, it's the ID, it's the attribute value, and this is it. It's sorted by the ID. So what happens is we scan the entire file. Well, not the file actually. We do not do any file operations when doing this. We keep this cached in memory. We cache this on startup or on index rotation, and we scan through this file. And actually, we try to avoid that to some extent. We do not have any advanced indexing over this, but there is a certain. I can see it here for some reason, but there is an internal block level index on top of that file that gets built when the file gets pre-cached in chunks of something like 64 rows or 100, 286 rows actually. And if the query, if the scanner basically sees that nowhere else in the blood satisfy, could possibly satisfy the condition on the colon, it's going to throw away the entire blood. So it's doing blood level optimizations where possible. Well, that helps a bit, but you can put a line there. It's a far cry from a full-blown B3 index, anyway. But, well, it helps in something. It helps under certain scenarios, but basically you do not rely on that, and basically you just... when you're doing the performance estimates, you do not really want to rely on the fact of the block, of existence of the block index. You want to rely on the fact that, well, all the rows will be scanned at all times, basically. So this is it. In this case, it's just a full scan of the SPA file in memory, fully in memory, no I/O attached. In this case, it's where match test and handler equals 42. It's a full text search on test first, and then additional filtering, again using the RAM image of the file.
Okay.
And by the way, as you might have noticed, we have an implicit limit of 20, always a dash 2. This is one of the fundamental differences, by the way, between MySQL and Sphinx. In MySQL, you do not necessarily have a limit. You can just, well, basically pull everything from a database. In Sphinx, you always have an associated limit. Plus, you always have a limit on that associated limit called, so-called max matches directive, which is set to 100,000 in here. It basically means you can't go below, you can't fetch rows 100,000, below 100,000. You can't fetch row number 100,010 for one. So, that's rarely a bad thing actually, because, well, Google isn't going, Google won't let you page to page 1,000 in. And the actual users doing researches, they are not going to page 1,000 in. So basically, even just as slow as just 1,000 best matches is typically enough. 100,000 and maybe 500,000 is enough even for the most demanding applications, in which it's not the users who are actually working with the search results, but data mining robots. So, the only, in my opinion, the only situation in which we use the limit as high as 100,000, 500,000, the only situation is when you're doing a data mining search and you need to hand lots of data to a data mining robot or a team of analysts, which is pretty much the same, even though the analyst is human.
Thanks.
Okay, so, yeah, that's... But anyway, what I wanted to show actually was the SQL syntax. So there I have it. It has a limit, you can obviously work with that limit however you want. So it's 6 and 20 and so on and so forth. And also, by the way, the API also returns, the native API also returns some additional information attached to every result set, such as the grilled, per keyword grilled down, the amount of matches, and so on and so forth. So actually, in this case, this number, this particular number, it's not obtained using a separate request, like you have to do with MySQL. A typical approach with MySQL, right? Select count star where match, and you pull the number of matches, and then you page, and then you do the main query itself. This is not the case with Sphinx with the native API. You just fire a query and it returns you the matches, it also returns you the attached number of found rows. There's no way we could possibly insert that into this result set, so we've added a custom statement, show meet. Meet is good, show meta actually. It's pure connection, so we've just run a query and we can easily access and quickly access the additional meta information. The total found, the difference is the total number of rows you can't possibly access. While the total found is the number of rows processed. In this case, it's all the same. That's because max matches is pretty high and the frequency of the keyword is low. If I change max matches to 1000, for instance, like here, yeah, well, actually, main case is going to break because it's pulling all the rows to main case size. Side, but okay, let's not do that. Where say match V and now show that. Okay, so by the way, this is it. So total is 1000. So it means that the maximum possible offset in the previous query is 1000. This is going to return just one row. You see? You can't access row 2, 3, 4, 5. Offset is out of bounds. Well, you can, by the way, override that on the fly. And still access it. And the reason we are doing this, by the way, is exactly to avoid the problem that MySQL has, that web handling limit. The way MySQL handles a limit clause is like this. It always pulls all the rows and basically sorts them, all of them, in memory or in disk if you can't put everything in memory, can't hold everything in memory. And then applies offset limit on top of that and returns with data. Well, we definitely don't want to do anything that inefficient, so we always enforce it to have a reasonable limit by using the max matches, the limit, and so on. And we keep at most max matches of rows at all times in the memory. We keep a priority queue of max matches, current matches. And even though in this example we honestly processed 47,000 matches, even though we honestly processed every single one of those, which is always the case with Sphinx, by the way. It always honestly processes all the full text rows. It's always honestly doing all the job. It's not cheating. It's not like throwing away 30,000 rows because, well, we have enough already. It's not doing that. It's always honestly processing all the rows. Even though it honestly processes 40,000, 40 million, 5 billion rows, it was, at any given point in time, it was still keeping just 1,000 rows, current best matches. It wasn't wasting memory on the process. Now, yeah, and well, in show meta you also have the keywords and the core keyword statistics, just how much documents every keyword matched, just how much occurrences of the keyword were found in all those documents, stuff like that. So, this is it. Sphinx QL. Right. Pretty convenient, in my opinion. I mean, just regular MySQL client. I can even stop the MySQL server. It's still going to work, obviously. We do not need MySQL server for that. What is next? So, yeah, so far, so good. We've implemented something, indexed sort of DB. And how do you update it? Well, in a sense, we've already covered this. So, the only way you update, well, let's go through it quickly just once again. The only way to update the data in the index, in the current version, well, there's no way to update the data in the index in the current version. The only way to do something, the only operation you can do to the index is basically rebuild it from scratch. So, so how do you update the index? It's just that. So, okay, so far so good again. So, yeah, you rebuild it from scratch, and what is happening here is that you see, it's pulling all the data again, all the data, and rebuilding it again, and then sending a signal to the search daemon that the indexer just built a new copy of the index for it, and that the search daemon should pick it up. Well, in this particular example, it's only taking 10 seconds, right? So you basically can rebuild every minute. The database is pristine enough to be rebuilt every minute from scratch, it's still going to be okay. Which is definitely not always the case. So, how do you fix that? What if your database is 8 million rows, not just 80,000 rows? You use so-called delta approach, and you use the multi-index queries. So, I think I'm going to combine that with the live hacking session as well. So, I can insert a new bug here, right? And after I insert just one, after I record just one new bug here, I do not really want to rebuild the entire collection. I basically only want to have that one new bug entered into the system, added to the index, but I can't update the index. I only can rebuild it from scratch. The solution is pretty obvious. We create several indexes, one index that carries the archive data, one index that carries the all the recent changes, and we somehow differentiate the data. We need some mechanism to tell that this data belongs in the old index, and these are those three rows that were just inserted that we wanted to access. How do we do that? For instance, well, the roots, there are many roots to that, actually. I'll do the simplest, but frankly speaking, the worst possible way. Not the worst possible way, but the second worst possible way. Well, actually, just kidding. Doing it by ID is good enough. So, what we're gonna do is do something like this. Let's create a helper table on MySQL. MySQL means something. Let's create a helper table with an index name key var character something, and the maximum ID we just indexed. Okay, there we have it. And I forgot to make it unique. Table helper, create table helper, la la la. Index name worker, or primary cache delivery. Now, every time we rebuild the main index, we would also store the maximum ID we've just indexed into that helper table, using the last queries, by the way. Something like this, place into a helper, select Montes, let's make it Montes, maximum ID from something, from Montes body, that is it. That's going to be our that's going to be our differentiator value. So let's see how it works. So we're doing a full rebuild of the main archive just once again. It's taking its toll, it's 10 seconds, maybe 10 hours on a fighter collection. And something should have just appeared in the help of it. Okay, there we have it. So the maximum indexed ID was something like this. Now, we also set up a new index, a new delta index. We can, by the way, inherit it from the from some other source. I mean, we can inherit the source, we can then as well inherit the index. And the query is pretty much the same. But first, we do not want the past query to happen here. This is the first thing. And second, we do not want to index all the rows. We only want to index some of the rows, and I'm going to use, and I think I'm going to use the arrange queries for that, where bid between start and end. So as far as I remember, maybe it will be shown. Source is called delta, and we also need to fetch those boundaries somehow, fetch those ranges somehow. And for the, and we'll use our helper table for that. So let's select each ID as our minimum value, each ID plus one actually, because each ID is indexed already. And max BID is our top value from helper H, make this bug table B, and this is pretty much it. I'm not sure if this query is going to fly, but hopefully it will. So what are we doing here? We are adding a range. We could have added it to the original source, by the way, and saved on the configuration. And we've just configured a new source that will try to index only the newly inserted rows. Only the rows inserted since the last time we've rebuilt the index, the test one index. Okay. And we've just configured the source, we also need to configure an index that works with that source. Index delta, source is delta, and file name is delta, and everything is delta. And yeah, this must be it. And well, let's try it. It should. Okay, where are
there is no sources.
Source one is
yes,
the name of
source. Right. Source one, not just a source. Source. Okay, I'm not going. Something was wrong with the syntax. What? Unknown count HID? That is interesting. What did it say once again in the field list?
HID.
How come it's unknown? Oh, you're right, it's not ID, it's max ID. Because now. Oh my, if there is no group like loss, it's going to be a headache. SQL side headache though. Well, I guess we should be able to do something like this. Oh. Or this, where each index name is, oh, sorry, equals mantis, by the way. Wonder if this is going to work.
Maybe you should try it with a, you have like select h max id plus one and then max. I don't think that
yeah.
It is, well, maybe mean of h max id plus one, that it will give the same result probably. And it
well, probably, yeah, maybe so.
I think
this could possibly do.
Yeah,
dead. Okay, I'm gonna win this battle anyway. we'll just hack and hack him until we get it done. Okay, good. Finally,
yeah.
We managed. Teamwork did it. We wrote just the right query. So, with a bit of, well, SQL fighting, we wrote the query that pulls the lower bound from the helper table, pulls the upper bound from the leading table, from the bug table itself. And so delta index is re-indexed in an instant. It doesn't have any rows. Now, well, let's report some issue and see if that works. Summary. Hello world from Reddit, right? Demo. Necessary field of it. Oh my. Okay. Good. So we've just submitted the issue. Now, we've. Now when we rebuild the delta index, It's already built in that single document inserted since the last time we've rebuilt the manual file. And by the way, when we are going to run it for the second time, it's going to rebuild just one document again. Because, well, essentially nothing changed. And again and again. If we report just one more issue at this point, it should rebuild just two rows at this point. And it does. And that's, so that's instant. So we are already building the rows that we really need to rebuild. Now, now how do we query those? Pretty simple, actually. Oh, I'm connected to Sphinx now. Good. So, where mesh Zeta? This is not going to fly, but we can enumerate the two new indexes. It's going to be that delta is not linear at this point, because we've added the index to the configuration file, we've created it, we've rebuilt it, but we did not let the daemon know that we've just added a new index. Well, it's a matter of a hub signal, I believe. Okay, except when it isn't. Okay, I guess I'll have to restart it for some reason. Okay, so the restart helped for some reason. Normally it should be a matter of hub signal. I have totally no idea what just went wrong. And yeah, and there we have it. And once we've set up a delta index, or by the way, a cascade, a set of several different delta indexes, we can query all of them at the same time, essentially. So we just enumerate the indexes here in the query. So I'm using SphinxQL for my examples, but it's exactly the same with all the other different XS methods. It's exactly the same as Sphinx API. You need to specify an index name there, and you just specify a comma-separated list of indexes. And that is it.
Are they queried in parallel? Is the Sphinx querying all of them in parallel using multicore or something, or sequentially?
In this case, it's querying them sequentially. And if we, for instance, use the syntax to... this is to illustrate that it's actually mixing the results. So if you remember, this row was our last match, last possible match, and the keyword V matches pretty much everything, right? And Zebra is unique, it only matches this row. So as you see, the query worked, and it worked against the two indexes, and the results were all glued together. You can see the results from the delta index and the results from the main index. And you're not limited to just two indexes, right? You can have as many as you need to. There are actually production instances querying as much as maybe 100 of different indexes. It works well, good enough for that. The purpose, by the way, of having as much as 100 indexes is something like they are doing a pure weak index. They are keeping those customers have a lot of the data flow in it, and they need to retire it. Sometimes they need to rebuild it on a weekly basis. So to simplify the maintenance for them, they are keeping the data forever given week since the start of the year in separate index. Plus, within every given day, they are using something like a separate index for every given hour, again, for the purpose of improving the indexing performance. Just because they index a lot of data every hour, right? So basically, it's one thing if you index just 1,000 rows every hour. 1,000 rows, it's going to take take you, I don't know, a split second to reveal that. Those guys are making like millions of rows per hour for some reason. I don't really know where is the data flowing from, but there you go. So, in their case, they're using a complicated setup scheme with lot of indexes, with lots of indexes, per week indexes, per hour indexes, and at the end of the week, they're actually taking, at the end of the day, they're actually taking 24 by hour indexes, merging all them together, creating a per day index. At the end of the week, they're merging them into a per week index. So, sort of a quado, but then again, I don't think any automatic solution would do a good job for them in their case. So, with Sphinx, they sort of have the control, right? If they want to have 24 indexes for every given hour, they can do that. If it's good enough for them to have, say, 6 indexes for 6 4-hour indexes, they can do that. If they decide to switch from weekly indexes to monthly indexes tomorrow, they can do that. The technology does allow, is flexible enough to allow them to do pretty much anything. Anyway, too much information again, perhaps. Now, yeah, what actually happens on SIGHUB signal?
I'm sorry, I need to leave.
Yes,
so
sure.
Thank you very much for the
yeah, Miro will have to work as your backup.
Yes, yeah. Good job.
So,
thank you.
Yeah. So, what actually happens on that SIGHUB signal that apparently didn't work for some reason? What happens is two or three things, actually. No, just two. So first, the search daemon rewrites the configuration file. It tries to pick up the new indexes and changes in the configuration of different indexes. So basically, it rewrites the configuration file. Plus, that isn't the only thing that is happening. What is more interesting is that on SIGHUB, it also goes through the index files and looks for the updated data files. So it's masterfully illustrated if we stop the daemon and look at the directory of the delta files, so with the data files. So these are our data files. What happens if we say rebuild delta with that rotate switch? As you see, Indexer just created a set of new files, a shadow copy of the index. It didn't actually exist a copy of the delta. So that the searches against this existing delta index would not be interrupted while Indexer is working. Now, when you send a hub signal to Search Daemon on the fly, it checks for these new files, and if it sees a valid set of new files, it picks that data up and starts working with the new data and throws away the old files. So, well, it's like a 5-millisecond long process in this case, so it's really easy to, it's next to impossible to show, I don't know, live. We're just not going to catch the moment when the new files still exist in the file system, which is why I had to stop Search D. And by the way, it's also going to pick up the new files on startup. So, well, I started to, it notices there are new data files, it's picking them up. When? Thank you, man. No new files, it just picked them up, it removed the old ones, it's using the new copy one. And this is what happens on SIGHUB, and this is the whole concept of, well, index rotation, of updating the data in Sphinx. And this is also how you tackle, well, the partial updates of the index. So, rebuilds, rotation, the only way to, summary, the only way to update the data in the index is to rebuild from scratch. Now, the mechanism of getting the new data to the search daemon is rotation, which happens on the hub signal, and the recommended way with the current version, with zero something versions to update the indexes is to have a separate index carrying the updates, rebuild that separate tiny index carrying the updates, and query both indexes at a time, or three indexes at a time, and that's about it. And that's how you update the data in your indexes on the fly in 0 seconds instead of 10 seconds. This is pretty much it concerning rotation. Now, there was a certain problem with deltas still. So we can now efficiently ship new data to search T, but what happens when we query against the old data? So let's see. So this is our test query. And the first document that it returns is document number 257. What if we just delete this issue? What's going to happen? So we've just deleted something, and we revealed the delta index and the updates. It did reveal all the updates, but the problem here is that if we are searching for something, oh, so it was test. Match test. And the limit should be a bit higher. Then the row that we just killed is still there. So you see, the row was killed, but search does not really have a way of knowing about it. That's part of the problem. Now, the other issue is what if we update some issue? How do we truly update it? Okay, so again, it's better explained with an example. So the nodes are all indexed, and I'm adding some new unique keyword to the bug number one. What's it going to be? Let's write DC 2010. One. And no. Oh. Unfortunately, the delta is not picking the rows based on the update time. At this point, it's only picking the new inserted bugs. So I guess we can also quickly hack it from, so it will also pick the update rows. Oh, that was Sphinx. And I needed to go to MySQL now. Okay, so in reality, when you do have the data that possibly gets updated, in some cases the data never gets updated. Like, for instance, when you're crawling the view data from somewhere, it's essentially immutable. So the scheme with IDs works more or less good. In other cases, the data can't possibly be updated. And in that case, you need to create your deltas differently. So in this case, I used IDs, but I shouldn't have. Instead of storing the maximum possible ID, I should instead have stored something, what was the column name again, last updated time or something. Yeah, it's just last updated. So instead of storing the maximum indexed ID, which is pretty much nothing, I should have stored the maximum last updated time in the helper table, and then I should have rows updated or inserted since the last point in time. I think I'm going to skip this for now, just to save time. But the problem here is as follows. Assume we've just updated the entire row. But, well, matrix is not the very best sample for this because we can't really easily update this entire text. Well, I'll have to click through all the delete buttons and delete all the nodes. But imagine a situation where I delete all the nodes in this issue, right? Then add the new node with a new unique keyword, DC2010. And when the delta index picks that new URL, because it was just updated, because last updated time is fresh now, what's going to happen in that case? When we query for the new keyword DC2010, the search is going to return this row, the first row, for this new keyword DC2010, right? But the problem is that the data in the existing index is still in place, in the main index called test 1 or something. And when I, for instance, query for I manage to reproduce this issue, then this query is still going to be satisfied using the existing index, the existing archive index. It's still going to return me the row number 1 from the main part, which hasn't been reindexed just yet. So essentially we are having a phantom problem. Essentially we are seeing a phantom row matched, that can be matched using the old keywords that are no longer in the database. We can still see that row when querying for the old keyword. And we need some, and ideally we need some mechanism to help that. Well, and obviously there is such a mechanism, at least there is now. So, yet another sort of important option that can be attached to SQL queries is so-called SQL query kill list. It's basically yet another query that must pull the list of all the IDs that that should be removed from the existing indexes. Now, what is this thing with kill list all about? Basically, we have a big index, we have a big main index, which takes a long time to rebuild. We don't want to touch it at all. We want to add new data, this is what we create the deltas for, and put the newly updated and new inserted rows in those deltas. But we still have a problem with phantoms, with rows that still exist in the main index, and that we want sometimes cleaned when we delete the rows or update rows. Now, we should keep track of these rows somehow. Basically, we should in this example, we should patch the metrics source to store the list of deleted IDs and store the list of updated IDs with attached timestamps, for instance, to some helper table again. So, well, I don't think we should do it right here, right now, as long as you get the idea. It's a matter of tweaking your web application a bit. I mean, I'm not the Metis web developer, right? So it is going to take me some time to find the right place in the code, insert a couple of additional SQL queries to do that. But I believe that if you're working with your own web application on a daily basis, you sort of know where the rows get deleted, where they get updated, and where should you insert that, kill list breaking code. Anyway, you store the list of deleted and updated rows since the last time. You use it using the kill list directive, and you use it to suppress the rows from the main search results.
You could also do it at the database level using triggers, right?
Yes, exactly. Well, except that
if you don't want to modify application for some reason or another.
Yeah, exactly. Well,
it's closed.
Provided that your database has a working implementation of triggers, which is definitely fun in MySQL direction. Plus, frankly speaking, I don't really know how to use MySQL triggers because
it works even nice.
Yeah. Well, yes, sort of chicken and egg problem, right? The triggers don't work, so I don't know how to use them. So when they suddenly start to work, or when they would be nice for a demonstration, I still don't know how to use them. Anyway, it should be, however, easy to show how the kill list work. And so currently, when the user syncs, yeah, this is. Currently, when we query by test keyword, it return the error number one. If it were by Zabber, it should return us to the only the new server growth, so everything seems to be working. Okay, so far so good. So the queries on new keyword work fine. The newly added rows work. The query on the old keyword work. Imagine for a second that the row number one is no longer associated with the keyword test and we do not want it in the search results. Assume that there is a copy in the delta index. What do we do? Basically, we attach a key list query to the delta source. Like I said, we do not want to touch the main index anymore, right? We want to be able to rebuild the delta very quickly, very efficiently. We do not want to touch the main index. So we do it like this. Well, select one is obviously an exaggeration. You'd be pulling data from your helper table that you've just entered your application. Now, we rebuild the delta one. And we query. And the row is no longer there. So we've just suppressed it from the main archive without touching it, without touching the main archive. Now, by the way, if we query the main archive only, the row is here, the row is back here. So
also the delta is suppressing the
yes, one. Exactly. So basically the kill list is a special magic filter attached to a delta index. And by the way, the order of indexes in the query does matter. So you see in this case I'm querying them in sort of a reverse order and the row still is here. So what is happening now? What is happening here? This so-called kill list stacking, if you will. Kill list for the rescue, they do quite update and delete. Well, basically, K list do not do that automatically. You should do that in the application, then use K list to ship the data you have just cracked to search daemon. The question is one thing we should cover here is how K list work and how they stack. So, the K list, the kill list, is associated with the delta index here. Right? And it's affecting the kill list attached to index is affecting all the previous index, previous in a sense specified earlier in the query. So when we're querying the indexes in this order, test one and delta, test one is before delta in the query, right? And therefore the kill list from delta, which suppresses ID one, kills it from test one. Now when we reverse the order, the kill list attached to delta affects nothing. There's nothing before delta. And then at the point in time when we query test one, then again, there's nothing past it. There's nothing that could possibly suppress any rows from it. So the kill list doesn't really apply. So basically we specify the deltas in the order of recency, right? The most
is there a possibility to do this automatically? So that every index that is in delta is k-listed in the main?
Well, that's complicated. We could suppress the rows that are in delta technically, right? Because, well, we can see that rows 1, 2, 3, and so on are already in delta. That would indeed solve the issue with updates, that would automate the situation with updates. But this is just a half of the problem, right? That still wouldn't fix the problem with deletes.
Okay.
So, you see, you would still have to crack it somehow, and if you're cracking deletes, well, chances are it's easy enough to crack updates as well. And unfortunately, there's no good way we could possibly write deletes ourselves, so there we have it. But, well, then again, we just might add that helper in the future, so just to just to make it so you have to patch your application in just one point. where you are deleting the rows and don't care about all the points where you updated the rows. So yeah, that might be an option in the future. I guess the show time was somehow combined with the previous slide, so very good. Deltas, check. Rotation, check. Keyless, check. So yeah, basic session is all here. Yes, we should do a quick recap and ask if anyone has any questions regarding to what we have just covered. Or if we should skim really quickly, proceed and skim really quickly through the more advanced part. Okay, let's play. Or maybe make a short pause, but really short at this time, guys. Everyone is good. Excuse me. Well then, and now for something completely different. All we have discussed so far was basically on the topic of keyboard session. How do you, and on the topic of systems administration, if you are maintenance, how do you set up things, how do you index things, how do you update the data, use stuff like keylist, so on and so forth. Now let's talk about the tons, the linguistics. A signature 5-minute crash course into modern computational linguistics. Just kidding. There's been nothing to be modern or computational about it. It's a linguistics though. So, who knows what is morphological analysis all about? What's it and what is it for? Me neither. I mean, if you're going to be checking my words by the book, by the linguistics books, chances are the book will tell you something different and the book will be correct. So, I'll give it to you in, say, in layman's terms and freshman's terms. Basically, the morphological analysis is all about determining what part of the speech what part of the speech is this word in which tense is it, in which form is it, and reducing that keyword back to its normal form. It's, frankly speaking, it's quite a complicated problem because natural languages are really ambiguous. And the amount of ambiguousness, well, depends on the language, of course. It's a simpler problem in English, where words do not mutate too much, if you will. Basically, you don't have like 30 different words that all mean running and all mean running in different forms. You only have run, runs, running, and maybe the, because run is an irregular verb, you also have red. The second time, or what's it called? The past verb, whatever. Anyway, yeah, exactly, the past tense. So basically, you only have a few different, not that much different forms of any given keyword. Now, the situation in Russian, for instance, and in Croatian, I believe as well, is much more difficult because of all the different,
I said forms, and you said it's not a form. We're talking about.
Well,
how do you mean to know the
Well, in a broad sense, it's still a form, a different form, a different time, a different voice, a different gender, and so on. But what I actually wanted to say is there's a lot of different prefixes, a lot of different suffixes to every given word, especially a verb, right? Which resulted in much more than just, five different forms that can be moreover can be built using a number of, pretty simple rules, right? So, in English language, it's like I run, and he runs, she runs, and I was running, he was running, she was running, that is just three forms, right? And if run was regular, that's it. So, just a single suffix s on the end plus just a single suffix I and g on the end, that's it. Just two and two rather simple rules. So the analysis in this case is more or less, you know, can be performed using a simple regular expression. Just strip all the s from the ends and ing from the ends, there you have it. In Russian and Croatian, it's in other inflectional languages, it's much more complicated. But, well, people are still doing it in Russian, I don't know. I don't think anyone's doing it in Croatian, though. That's like we discussed yesterday or the day before. That's a really complex problem. So ideally, for every given target language, you want a full-blown analyzer, a program that basically reads the text, understands what part of speech is used, understands each sentence, and for every given word thinks about what part of speech is it. And based on the part of speech plus a huge table of different forms, is able to reduce it to normal form as needed. So, even though it's simpler with English, I can still give you a couple of nice examples in English as well, with some morphological ambiguity. So, well, just to illustrate the complexity of the problem, if you will. So. Take these two phrases, I dove into the pool, where dove is a verb and is a past tense from dive, right? And the other phrase is why dove, why with the wing, where dove is a noun here. Now, the ideal morphological analysis tool would be able to read these two sentences, understand that in this case, dove is a verb, a past tense from dive, and based on that information, convert it back to the original form, which is dive, and be able to find the and therefore enable the keyword search engine to find this document by the dive keyword. And it would be able to set imaginary ideal morphological analysis too. Would be able to understand that in this case, in this context, the keyword is not about swimming, right? It's a dove. Golub in Russian. Don't really know the Croatian word.
The same.
Perfect. Well, unfortunately, that's an extremely complex test, and I'm not even aware. I'm aware of certain efforts on the way for different languages. For Russian languages, there's a library that tries to do this, and for English languages, there were, I believe, some university-based projects. But unfortunately, that's all pretty complex, and pretty much the only guys doing this are the groups of computational linguists that earn their salaries in major web search companies, because pretty much no one else have the guts or the cash to work on it. So the ideal morphological analysis tool is something ideal, but unfortunately not really accessible at this point, or really doable in a reasonable time frame. That would make a nice 30-year-long open source project, I believe. Unfortunately, I do not yet already have. I do not have 33 man years up my sleeve. So, poor man's morphological analysis tool would be called Lemur. It's something a bit simpler. So, what if we drop the sentence analysis, the part of speech tagging part, from this process? It's going to produce some error. If we don't know that in this case dove is a verb, and we should reduce it to dive. And if we don't know that in this case dove is a noun, we are going to confuse these two documents, whether or not they are found by the dove form or by the dive form. But at the same time, we still would be able to find a keyword find a document in which a keyword is in a slightly different lexical form, but in, well, more or less the same semantical form. What I'm saying is, we still would be able to find the document that's speaking to, that speak about running or diving or whatever when querying for just run, dive, and so on and so forth. Once again, this isn't really much of a problem for English per se, by the way. Much less of a problem, because, well, it's much less inflectional. It's a much bigger problem for Russian and Croatian, but unfortunately there's no good solution for that. But, well, there's still something that people try to do. So, the ideal lemur, so-called lemur, or lemmatizer in full, is a program that does not do any sentence analysis, but works with particular words. Pretty much without knowing whether it was a verb or a noun, and which context it was used. So the ideal lemur, the ideal lemmatizer, is something that can take any given word and reduce it to the normal form. Reduce running back to run, reduce dive back to dive, perhaps because dive is much more frequent than dive the noun, and so on and so forth. Now, turns out that even the lemmatizer rules are pretty complex to get right, get done right. Though in that case, so that's perhaps not a 30-year-long project, that's maybe just a 15-year-long project. So, the usual, the common poor man's solution is the renowned stammer approach, which is, well, basically, stammer is, well, it is the first step to implement a full-blown lemmatizer, just not really completed, just without that much linguistical effort put into it. The implementations are pretty much all the same, and revolve pretty much around the same ideas anyway. They all revolve around a set of rules, sets of exceptions, and attempts to analyze the keywords. Except that what is typically called stammers is a small enough bit of code that only knows about a few. Well, a few bilinguistical standards, by the way, can pretty much rules by the programmer's standard amount of rules. I mean, it might have like 50 to 200 different programmatical rules that try to reduce keywords to their normal forms. But, well, unfortunately, it's still not enough because natural languages are complex. So, there is a number of well-known... There is a collection of, renowned collection of stammers. The Snowball project, which is a collection of, well, different stammers. So, if for some reason you're interested in this, you can just go check this out. The algorithm, they describe the algorithm, the classic one for stem in English language, and you can see the rules here, how they process the words. And the fun part about it is, even though there's, you see, a fair amount of different rules happening, it's still not barely enough to cover the entire language, just because of the sheer complexity of natural languages. Anyway, stammers are, well, good enough approximation to the lemmers, and lemmers are in turn, well, good enough approximation to the ideal morphological analyzer tools, which do not really exist. So, yeah, crash course into linguistics, like I promised. And, well, granted, there is a nice library that supports quite a number of different stammers for different languages. It would be a shame not to steal it, so we definitely did. Sphinx let you things lets you build it with libstammer support. We definitely do not just pick the sources and bundle it with our code, because, well, for two reasons, essentially. For a licensing reason, for one, plus we don't really want to tie the users of particular version of Sphinx to particular version of particular old version, perhaps old and buggy version of Stammers. So we are sort of forcing you guys to download Stammer library separately, work with it. Anyway, thanks to the Snowball project, all free and open source and blah blah blah, we do at least have Stammers. Stammers, like I quite tried to explain, are definitely far from being ideal. They are not even close to ideal lemur tools, which are in turn not even close to ideal analysis tools, but there we have it. Stammers do mistakes, so I think there should be like Dino somewhere. Okay, there we have it. Stammers do mistakes, so basically when you're stemming running in English, it's pretty good, right? So it reduces it to the proper normal for running. And I believe something like importance should be also handled. So, okay, so importance was a nice sample of a mistake, right? So importance and the verb to import is something different, right? But in this case, just because of the empirical rules that the stammer used, which are okay per se, the rules are okay themselves. So there's a bunch of different other words that end with "ans" prefix in English that should be processed using exactly these rules. But in this particular example, it's not really working well. It's reducing importance to "imper," which is not the right original form.
But it's the false positive. But if you have importance in your source data and your user enters importance, it will get stamped to the same word, so you will still get the document.
Yes, exactly.
You will get false positives, but
yes,
at least you will not lose anything.
Yes, exactly. That is correct, of course. So you might that's basically all. The complexity of morphological analysis is basically all about reducing the amount of noise. I only want those matches that I want. I can't possibly understand why is the search engine returning me the documents on the import-export operations when I'm searching for something of big importance. But I still do not really want that noise. Well, unfortunately, that's a huge test. My favorite example is actually not importance. Importance is going to be the next big one. So perhaps laziness, by the way, is okay. It gets reduced to lazy with ionent, and lazy with ionent is reduced to the same normal form. But my favorite example of, well, a stammer failing is actually business. So business is a word in itself, right? But unfortunately, there's a rule in the stammer that reduces the nest syntax, and it reduces business to just busy. Which is also the form for the verb busy. So every time you are searching for someone very busy, you are ending up with the results for all the different businesses. So, how do you live with it? With all that knowledge? And what can Sphinx do for you, and what it can't do for you? What we can do is, first, we have our own built-in implementations of English and Russian and, I believe, Czech stammer. Those are available immediately in the cloud. So you just go to your index, which was named test one, and it's something like morphology equals stem n, and you enable stemming on the keywords both indexing and search attack. You can stack the stammers, so you can apply, if the languages sort of don't overlap, right? If they are using different ranges of characters, you're fine with something like this. So assume you have a mixed English plus Russian collection. who are mixed English plus Croatian collection, if you will. Unfortunately, we don't have a standard for Croatian though. But anyway, you can mix these stammers, and in case the first is going to work, like if the first stammer wasn't able to do anything to the word, it doesn't even recognize the characters in the English versus Russian case, it's going to apply the second stammer, and if it fails to apply the second stammer, you might then apply some other stammer and so on and so forth. So, I can't really give you any good examples of people doing this. Can't name anyone off the top of my head. But I believe that a bunch of users in Russia is doing this for one. So, it's definitely of interest here. That should definitely be of interest here in Croatia. Perhaps some of you guys could hack together a Croatian stammer, at least something that resembles a working solution. Now, we do also have a concept of word forms which tries to attack the morphology problem, the morphological analysis problem, from a totally different angle. The one approach, the programmatical approach, if you will, is stemming. So, stemmer is essentially an algorithm. It's any algorithm, so this is the listening sum of several language snowball.
You will be assigned here later.
Wow. This is the full algorithm. You can see, by the way, all those reduction rules that get applied, that are applied on top of the word, all of the mistakes. So that is one of the possible approaches. Ideally, we would possibly have a huge list of all the possible keyword forms in the language, and along with all the normal forms attached to those possible keyword forms. So running map to runs, running maps to run, runs map to run, and ran map to run, and so on and so forth. Well, turns out it's not really that huge amount of data by nowadays standards. I mean, in Russian, it's conceived, sort of. In Russian language, there should be maybe a million or two of different keyword forms, right? And with an average entry size of, like, I don't know, 32 bytes, 64 bytes, and 2 million rows, that's not really super much data for modern machines to handle. So, and this is how word forms thing was born. So basically, word forms file has a very simple format. It's just a huge list of different mappings from the source form to the destination form. It gets applied. It gets applied to the keywords both at indexing and insertion stage as well. So, well, sort of automatical. And that's the other approach to tackle the morphological issues. The one approach is stemming, programmatical, false positives, mistakes. The other one is the huge dictionary. Of course, actually, none of the approaches actually work, right? The stammers makes mistakes. On the other hand, whatever the size of your dictionary, you always risk that something that people really want isn't really in your dictionary. So, no good solution for that. Well,
in which order are they applied? If I'm using stammer and dictionary, is it first stemmed and then replaced, or the other way?
Which is exactly my next point. So the best thing we could possibly do, and we're doing it already, is letting you combine these things. So I just made an example which does something to reduce run into the proper neural form, which is sort of redundant. You can do this, you can do the upper part on running with just the stemmers. And the interesting thing here is how I've added a couple of rules to alleviate the problem with business. In case you enable both the word forms and the stemmers, they are applied in word forms file, then the stemmer. So basically, if you have a good enough and big enough word forms dictionary, then most of the words are going to be processed by the dictionary, and the business problem is going to be fixed. And then, all the other words, all the other unknown words that are not in the dictionary, and all the other unknown forms that are not in the dictionary, are going to be processed by the stemmer. So, well, like I said, it's a far cry from a full-blown morphological analysis tool which would comprehend the language and talk to you like a real-life person, but it's sort of the best we can do in the current situation. So, yeah, this is how we do it. Now, like I mentioned, there's also a spell dump utility, which is basically a tool that you use to generate the big enough dictionary files from my spell files. Well, anyone curious enough to have it right here right now? Where should we leave that as an exercise to the readers?
Yeah. Can you do? How can you retrieve the path from MySQL?
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand how spell dump functions.
Okay, so I should have I hope I have OpenOffice dictionary installed somewhere here. I don't remember where are the dictionaries, the basis licenses program, my share packages. If I could only remember where are the... Okay, there we have it. So, yeah, takes some time to look those dictionaries up, but basically what spell dump is, it's able to take these dictionary and AFF affix files from either iSpell collection or from OpenOffice and create a huge word forms file from those. So, not sure if I'll be able to copy those over to individual machine, but let's try. Using these to make sufficient spelling correction, actually. Because, well, basically, this is a not, this is a perfect data structure for us to generate the entire, to generate all of the possible keyword forms in the language. Well, it's just perfect. It's just exactly what we need. At the same time, I have no idea how other, and then again, it's perhaps the easiest possible format for the linguist to work on the file, at the forms, at the new keywords here, and so on and so forth. I do not know how, just how do they work, how do they quickly search through this when doing spelling correction, but I guess they pre-built some index. Where are the index? Oh, anyway, it's done. In the meantime, processed 50,000 keywords that were in the dictionary, generated a 2.5 meg file, result file, which carries more workforce here. And basically, this is how it works. So, it used all the different rules specified in the spelling file and created all the possible methods. Let's check what's running. So, yeah, there we have it. Out running maps to run. Out runs map to run. According to the rules specified in the spelling file. So, this is all that the spell dump utility to do. It just, well, it's just a handy tool to build the Sphinx format stupid huge keyword tables, keyword mapping tables. From iSpell or MySpell format that everyone is used to. Now, Sphinx is pretty efficient, by the way, when handling word forms, because the feature was initially implemented with huge dictionaries in size. And last time you benchmarked, you could use a 10 million keyword form dictionary. This one is, by the way, just 100,000 forms. I think we've tried, well, 10 million might be an exaggeration, of course, but I think we've tried a dictionary that was built from concatenating the dictionary forms for several languages altogether, for English language, for Russian language, German, so on and so forth. So we've got a huge, really huge dictionary, like, 20, 50 megs in size. And interestingly, the both the index and insertion speed was pretty good. It was an impact of maybe just 20 or 30% compared to the regular indexing without any dictionary at all, just indexing the original keyword first. So it's surprisingly performant. Frankly speaking, when we were benchmarking that, I expected much more of a slowdown because you have to look up every given word in a huge enough dictionary doing a lot of memory regression. Well, that was not the case. So dictionaries are good. You can generate them, you can obviously edit them, you can edit the source form if it's more convenient for you, the rules, the source spell files where you can fix tweak the generated files. So, this is how you tackle morphologies, and the bottom line, this is how you tackle morphologies issues with Sphinx. You have these stammers, you have a couple of built-in stammers, you have an option to attach the lib stammer library and have stammers for 15 languages instead of really just 3. You also always have the last resort option of going and tweaking the word form dictionaries by yourself, which is, well, of course, a daunting task, but at the same time, not that much of a problem. I mean, fixing a single entry in a keyword dictionary is a boring thing to do, but you don't need to do it every single day.
Andrew?
Yeah?
Could we finish now and move to lunch, and we can speak during the lunch?
Okay.
Because I actually have to let people eat for next workshop. And let you eat also. There's something for you there. That's a lot.
Okay. Okay.
So if you could run over the slides, if you have anything else to show here, and we'll just move to the... So we can wait for the full
review. Okay, let's do this. Let me try to jump over the slides really super quick, then move to the lunch and discuss the particular important things over lunch. So, if I wasn't so slow a speaker, we would also have covered additional text processing magic. Sphinx, when you're using stem, Sphinx can also index exact words for you. It can also index subscripts, the beginnings of the words, the true subscripts within every given keyword. It's perfectly possible. There are certain ranking quakes when you use when you enable exact forms and substring indexes. Basically, if you're indexing a substring and you have a perfect keyword match, you want it ranked higher, you can do that with some, well, jumping through some hoops or by using the automatic query expansion feature plus so-called SPH04 ranker on top of that. So that's doable. Now, I was also going to cover the query syntax. Well, in or not brackets, phrase operators, and limiting the fields is the common stuff. We have a few full text operators that are sort of advanced and even unique. We have a multi-field syntax like this that lets you specify just a set of fields that you want to search. Well, it is advanced, but perhaps not unique. Proximity query, which lets you query for documents with keywords within given proximity. Well, too much words again. An interesting operator called quorum, which lets you to query for all the documents where you have only, say, three or more keywords from a given subset. So you are searching for 10 keywords, and you want all the documents with 3 or more keywords of those 10 returned. Why would you ever use that? Well, it all revolves about around the searching quality and the tricks you do to improve and continuously improve your searching quality and the search that you're offering to your end users. That's basically an endless story, an endless process. There's a lot you can do about it, and part of it has to be done on the application, part of it has to be done on Sphinx. So the approach with the Sphinx is generally you provide them with the tools, with the Lego blocks, and you build the Eiffel Tower out of these Lego blocks yourself. So, well, you know, as long as you can. I mean, if the thing is way too complex for you to build from Lego blocks, then you're definitely in a new feature. Yet another, your operator, by the way, is so-called before operator. It's something like that, and so you can query for A and something B, and it's going to enforce the strict order of the keywords. So I have totally no idea why the customer wanted this, but they did. Anyway, we might be able more strange, advanced, and unique full-text querying operators in the future. That's sort of within our current architecture. So, well, shameless plug applies. There also is a notion of so-called modifiers, keyword modifiers, that can be attached to every given keyword. The syntax is pretty much self-explaining, right? So this is the syntax you use to bind the keyword to the beginning of a given field. This is the syntax you use to bind it to the very end. This is the exact form operator, and this is, well, sort of an exception. This stuff looks like a field operator, a field limit operator, which is, by the way, goes like this, a title, hello world. The same thing is a bit different. It means it's a field limit plus a modifier on position, on keyword position. It means give me all the documents where there was a hello keyword within the first 50 keywords of the field. And, well, once again, that's all black magic and voodoo art, but when you start to go real deep into the improving the quality, the search quality, it all starts to, things come to pop up on the radar. And yeah, the important part about the quality is cheating on the queries. So you're not just firing the query, bypassing it from user to Sphinx. You can as well do something to the query. So Sphinx gives you tools to do that. It provides the various query statistics, and it provides the built keywords API call that you can use to split the query into particular keywords, and then reassemble that query into something that you need. So it basically gives you tools to rewrite the queries needed. One particular example would be typical correction suggestions. We do have a bundle sample that covers those suggestions, so you just go to the term pool and look into the MISC suggest sample. So this is it. The idea behind doing these typical corrections with Sphinx is pretty simple. Once again, we use Sphinx to pull a dictionary of data from your data collection, so it's tied to your particular data. It's your dictionary. It's not some custom dictionary from MySQL that doesn't even apply to your data. It's your very own dictionary. You use the this script to create an auxiliary dictionary and an auxiliary index of programs. So then you do some magic to the searching, and then all of a sudden you can basically filter a given keyword through this script and get it corrected with regards and get it corrected by your own dictionary. Well. And that's an example of what you can possibly do when rewriting the query. So, for instance, imagine, like I mentioned like 17 times already, it's all about improving the search quality. So, imagine the user fires a query and it returns zero results. What do you do? Well, the most dumb thing to do would be just say, oh, sorry, we found nothing. Well, the more advanced approach would be to start tweaking the query. So, for instance, you could look at the query, you'll check the keywords, try to find suggestions for those keywords that did not match anything, or find suggestions to those keywords that did match anything, but say, just match a single document of a 10 million long collection, and filter those through suggestions, and you can do that. And another interesting thing that you could possibly pursue is, well, like I said, a made-up, semi-made-up example. You're doing a reality search website, and the users approach you with queries like, rent a two-bedroom apartment for under 600 euro. Now, in this case, you could just, when indexing your data, you could just insert the additional keywords for rent, two-bedroom apartment, and so on and so forth into the full text index. So this part of the query would work. Under 700 euro, on the other hand, needs to be, removed from the query and inserted and reinserted back into the query, but as a filter, not as a full text part. And this is something you can possibly do and more or less easily do with using the magic like build keywords API call plus some custom code for your particular application, right? So under 700 euro for a relative-based website is a good idea, perhaps for general web search engine, less so. This is a long story. The explanation of our implementation of relevance, what is VM25 function all about, how is it computed, how do we compute our relevance, how do all the factors tie together. A long story indeed. And the last thing I was going to cover is a bit about scaling. So how you basically all the scaling is sharding the data, either automatically. All the modern SQL systems, by the way, are pretty much about the same thing. All the core competency, if you will, of the modern NoSQL systems is automatically sharding the data. At the same time, there's no other approach to scale than to shard. So how do you do this with Sphinx? You shard the data, you use so-called distributed indexes, you use masters, agents, perform rolling upgrades, fight with network infrastructure that connects, query timeouts, retries, and so on and so forth. And that was about it. So if you only had 8 hours instead of 3, or if I was a much faster speaker, they would have that covered by now. That is it. But then again, we can of course discuss everything that we want to and we need to over the lunch, or you know, just outside of the room.